Ha!
Short version, it's good. Go see it. Make sure you stay through the credits. Take the kids, they'll love it. No significant difference between the 2D and 3D versions, so don't sweat that. Long version? In 2001, at least four major superhero movies are hitting theaters within the span of only a few months, and out of all of them, Thor is not only the first horse out of the gate, it also represents the biggest gamble. Tasked not only with introducing mainstream audiences to one of Marvel Comics' most singularly preposterous creations, but also with introducing elements of fantasy and outright magic to Marvel's bold experiment in shared universe movie continuity en route to the genre-defying team-up feature The Avengers in 2012. And make no mistake, Thor is not playing it safe. This is balls-out, no-compromises cosmic fantasy, an action-adventure film that frequently looks less like a comic book than it does like a unicorn-encrusted trapper keeper, and begins with the kind of crazy big premise other films might spend a whole story explaining, namely that the ancient Norse gods, as in Asgard, Aesir, Rainbow Bridge, Jotunheim, Frost Giants, the whole shebang, actually did and still do exist. In the story proper, the time is coming for Odin, the king of the Viking gods, to retire and pass his crown to his son Thor, aka the God of Thunder, who's pretty much the chief ass-kicker of Asgard, but also kind of a pompous douchebag. When he pulls a particularly rash stunt, he winds up restarting a war between the gods and frost giants. Odin decides that Thor needs to have some humility beaten into him, so he takes away his godly powers and his signature weapon, the magic hammer Mjolnir, and busts them both down to Earth as punishment. If he wishes to be a god again, Thor will have to prove himself worthy as a human hero. This is easier said than done, as you'll recall from Iron Man 2, Mjolnir itself has been quarantined off by the shady government agency S.H.I.E.L.D., while back up on Asgard, Thor's brother Loki, the god of mischief, is using his brother's absence as the pretext for a coup of his own. On a technical level, Thor can be summed up as a triumph of execution. It doesn't have the most polished CGI in film history, and no amount of clever lighting could make the Asgardians' ridiculous sensibilities in the realms of costuming and architecture, both of them much more reminiscent of the 1980s Flash Gordon movie than anything in actual Norse mythology, look like something anyone would want to wear or live in, but the design of it is so strikingly original and proudly presented, it's kind of hard to care. This is the first Marvel movie to really go for broke in capturing the signature aesthetic sensibility that artist Jack Kirby brought to the original Thor comics, and the result is a blockbuster that looks utterly unlike anything you've recently seen in theaters. In a world where characters in shining armor blast across space on horseback through rainbow-colored wormholes to do battle with entire planets of towering frost giants, realism might as well be a dirty word, and Thor positively revels in its own visual absurdity, but without losing track of its narrative cohesion. Admittedly, part of that is because the narrative itself is made surprisingly simple. Eschewing the tendency toward grown-up time introspection as seen in Iron Man or The Dark Knight, Thor keeps things squarely in the broad, almost fairy-tale-like beats of the myths that inspired it. It's a story about a guy who was a jerk and has to learn his lesson before he can have his hammer back to fight monsters. That's it. Amusingly, despite the PG-13 rating, this makes it easily the most kid-friendly superhero movie since Spider-Man. But the main reason it works seems to be that Marvel made a crazy choice for the director, and it paid off. Kenneth Branagh, classically trained actor, highly respected star of stage and screen, is best known as an interpreter of Shakespeare and other serious dramatic fare, but he turns out to be a perfect fit for Thor's bombastic larger-than-life fantasy. Scenes of literal gods bellowing declarations of rage and honor in cavernous Asgardian halls crackle with real mythic intensity, the sort of thing that only those with a solid background in classical theatrical tradition can really pull off convincingly. As for the actors, Chris Hemsworth is an instant star, finding the humor and heart in the role of a mythic being stuck in a mundane world. Also, it must be said that it's about time for the usual dweeby guy, hot girl movie pairing to get turned the other way around, and Natalie Portman looks like she's having fun in that regard, playing a refreshingly ordinary, dressed-down, plain-Jane astrophysicist who draws the affections of a hero who may as well have jumped off the cover of a trashy romance novel. Tom Hiddleston makes for a great, tormented Loki, and Anthony Hopkins as Odin is Anthony Hopkins as Odin. And to everyone who pitched a fit about Idris Elba playing Heimdall, every scene he's in may as well be subtitled, "That's Why." I won't call it a masterpiece. Supporting characters like the Warriors 3 seem to be biding their time for a sequel, while Rene Russo gets almost nothing to do as Thor's mother. But when it works, Thor is the best kind of summer action movie. I'll also say that Marvel is getting much better at weaving the shared universe stuff into the plot. Clark Gregg as S.H.I.E.L.D. Agent Coulson owns every scene he's in. And while there is a surprise cameo by another prospective Avengers member, it plays out in a way that'll make fans smile but won't confuse everyone else. Those same fans will want to keep their eyes peeled during scenes in Odin's treasure vault, by the way, and of course for the now expected post-credits bonus scene, which might constitute the single biggest reveal since Marvel started this whole business. Alright, three down, one more to go. Please don't screw this up. I'll see you next time.